Bill, you were really part of the ragtime revival of sort of bringing this music back to public consciousness in the early 70s. Is this piece part of that, your sort of initial foray or connection with ragtime?
Actually, I wrote Rags from about 1967 on to a couple of years after Graceful Ghost, and occasionally one or two here and there after that. But I was doing that mostly at that particular time. I sort of fell into the whole ragtime revival, which had really not begun much in the United States. I found out it really had done pretty well around Toronto. Wonderful pianist, dead now, quite young. It's a great shame. It's a wonderful musician named John Arpin had been involved with a thing called the Ragtime Society. And there were people up there, and they'd had their ragtime. I didn't know about any of this. What had happened is that I'd had lunch with a very good friend of mine who had been the money man for music for both Rockefeller and Ford Foundation at different times, and he'd been a fan of my opera for actors, Dynamite Tonight. And we were talking. He said, you know, there's a man named Scott Joplin. Is that a name you know? I said, I've heard it. He says, yeah, well, he wrote Maple Leaf Riders in 1967. I said, oh. He says, well, he also wrote an opera in ragtime. And I can't find it. I've heard about it. And so on, he says. I said, well, you know what? That sounds interesting. So I started researching. After months of absolutely fruitless search, calling up the Library of Congress, and they said, if you ever find it, let us know. We have a card, and they would have no score. Yeah. And I tried everything. I tried the County Cullum Library. I tried the Museum of City of New York. I found, you know, Lincoln, you know, every place. And finally, I was coming back to my teaching job at Queens College, and Rudy Blesch, who taught the jazz course, one of those things where 300 people get up there and all. And there's a multiple choice question at the end. Billie Holiday was pitcher for the Baltimore Black Barons singer, you know, that kind of thing. So it was sort of like that. Anyway, so I asked Mr. Blesch, I said, I'm having a terrible time trying to find a score of Treemonisha. He says, well, I have one at home. Would you like to look at it? So he sent for me a copy from the Ragtime Society in Weston, Ontario, took it home. I was absolutely charmed. And then I want to know about the rags. He got me, Max Morath had put out a little unofficial 100 rags folio, and several Joplin rags were there. Meantime, I started to play these rags, and I was at a party around Christmas 1967 that Eric Salzman and Joshua Rifkin was there. And I started playing the rag, and he came up to me and says, well, what is that music you're playing? And he says, well, that is Scott Joplin. He says, oh, yeah, Scott Joplin. I know all about Scott Joplin. And he said, well, I'd like to learn to play some. So I told him how to get a copy of Max's folio called Max. Whereupon he went over to Nonesuch Records and recorded Scott Joplin. And that was the thing that made the real transition from the pop world to the, so to speak, hoity-toity academic world of, you know, Highline people and scholarship and H. Wally Hitchcock and everybody is having to do with, you know, the serious pursuit of the American vernacular stuff. And so between that and other things, I mean, Josh did a whole career as a pianist doing that for a while. And I started doing a bit of it myself, and I began to become good friends with U.B. Blake through Robert Kimball, the scholar in musical theater, and started touring with him a little bit and playing this and that and so on. And that's really what happened. I started writing my own, and Bill Albright, whom I'd met here, I'd met at Tango in '66. He got interested. He also, I find out now, had played some rags before I even knew about it. So we started writing our own rags and sending them to each other. And next thing you know, we started playing concerts together. And we did the first real concert of music in the Walker Arts Center Recital Hall, which has been replaced, of course, with the rebuilding of the Walker Center. But ours was the first real concert. And we just listed all the rags and took a piano, and he said, we'll do some of the selection of the following. Some were Joplin, some were the other writers, and so on. And the rest is that. I have 22 published rags out. They've been published. They've been recorded by me and a lot of other people. And Graceful Ghost is probably far and away the most well-known.
It's a little exceptional as far as a rag. I mean, we'd expect something, at least in the popular imagination, that's sort of up-tempo, virtuosic. Well, and this piece is sensual, and it's slow, and there's even some rubato.
Well, the rubato is only the choice of the performer. It should basically still be danceable. But the fact is that it was a slow dance. Joplin should be played not in a great hurry. That was the urban thing that would happen after that. Even his rags would speed up toward the end. I think you can't do the magnetic rag as slowly as you might possibly have done the Maple Leaf, for example. So, I mean, that was what happened. But also there was Joseph Lamb, who was somebody, one of his proteges, who wrote these very sensual rags. And uh, it was in memory of my father, and so it's kind of, that's why it's in B flat minor and kind of elegiac. But no, slow rags are something that were a constant in the early years, and it would be just as everything speeds up, and that's what happened. So I think what happened with that's what made Griffin's playing so striking, is it was so slow, kind of Brahmsian. And I think that's what made the difference for a lot of people.
When it brings out the syncopation, when we really have the slower pulse, and it's not a novelty rag like a Zez Confrey or something. Like
that. No, no, those were meant to be fast and furious and fancy. But that was the urban style. That was Baltimore, where Scott Joplin really came from the small towns where you'd have this sort of very easy kind of gait. And I don't think he ever settled comfortably in New York, even though he was there for the last years.
So does the melody that you choose in this piece, does that reflect your father as well, or is it more
the
idea?
It kind of does. I mean, he was a very gentle man. I used the title Graceful Ghost because the ghost being in the sense of the Miltonic use for spirit. And it's been mistitled by all kinds of people. Oh, we love your grateful goat. We love your gray ghost. You know, I've got all these things. For some reason, I have a genius for picking out titles that sound too much like something else. No, The Graceful Ghost is an elegiac rag in memory of my father, whom I really adored. He was anything but a macho man. He was very gentle. He had many, many friends. And he was a very good dancer, as it turned out. My mother and he would be out there on the floor, and he had a flair for that sort of thing. So that's why he became The Graceful Ghost.
For the performers realizing this score, what do you think is essential for really bringing out the character of this piece or of its ragtime?
It should be, first of all, I don't like this kind of triplety way of doing it. Dump-a-dump-a-dump-a-dump. People do that for rag. It takes all the stuffing out of it. It should be almost straight eighths. It's close to what probably Noti Nigal were, because, you know, I don't think it was dumba 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 dumba. You know, it's a little bit of emphasis on the other, and so it's only a tiny bit more on the other, every other, or, you know, first one, but that's, I think, the whole thing. So you want to keep that straightness. I think, and all the melodic parts should be played, you know, songfully and well. I mean, I think don't doctor it up; just let the piece do itself, I think.
Mm-hmm. Anything else about this piece in particular we should be sure to cover?
Graceful Ghost. Well, a friend told me that's the one thing I have written that will have any kind of life in the future centuries. Well, that's fine. It's certainly possible. And if that's so, if I have a tiny little corner or something, that's all right. There's an awful lot of music out there.